The purpose of this press conference is to report on some of the deliberations during the last couple of days and some resolutions which were passed by the Assembly today. We have some press releases which are comprehensive, so please don't worry too much about taking comprehensive notes. There should be sufficient information there for you to know the details, so I'll just touch on some key points. A number of these issues I raised in my presentation this morning as to why they're important to the industry and the regulatory priorities. So the basic themes were laid out then. I'll try and explain the essence of what are the points we're trying to make. We're in a highly regulated industry, and that accounts for a very strong record of safety and security and sustainability. And the whole aviation system works as well as it does because of the regulatory framework. But having said that, clearly managing a global network, an industry which is a global network, we need harmonized global standards, and that means countries getting together to agree on standards and implementing them the way that works smoothly together. We talked quite a bit today about sustainability and the environment, talked about safety, talked about security and passenger facilitation, and we've also talked about taxes and charges and the detriment they can cause to the industry. Let me run through the resolutions one at a time on safety oversight. Safety is the aviation industry's first priority, and I showed data which confirmed that the industry is extraordinarily safe and getting safer year by year. And so there is no, essentially there is not a safety problem, far from it. But I highlighted the fact that notwithstanding that exemplary safety record, the system of regulatory oversight has weaknesses, in particular the inconsistency of implementation of regulatory oversight by different countries. And whilst that doesn't represent a threat to safety, what it has led to is a lack of confidence and trust between governments and an excess of overlapping and duplicating audits. And in some cases, the imposition of sanctions, not always against other countries, but sometimes against airlines as an indirect means of pressuring other governments. So we as airlines have an interest in strengthening of regulatory oversight, supportive of the ICAO No Country Left Behind campaign, which aims to reduce these disparities. And the resolution essentially makes that point. It also says that any additional restrictions should be based on transparent criteria and strong evidence. And if foreign carriers are going to be subject to sanctions, they should be given the opportunity to demonstrate that their safety systems and performance are in compliance with accepted international standards, as invariably they are, before any such sanctions are imposed, because our experience is it's asymmetric. Getting out of a list or out of sanctions is much more difficult, time-consuming, may take months or years. It's more broadly acknowledged now that the issue is not airlines and their adherence, it's the fact that the regulatory oversight is patchy. But again, don't confuse this with any immediate concern about safety. There is no such concern. And the regulators deserve the credit for being part of the system that makes it as safe as it is. Moving on to security, again, air travel is safe, secure, and convenient, but we can never be complacent, and we do need to think about threats to security, which are many and varied. And security procedures are an integral part of flying, and probably the least attractive part of the flying experience, according to what passengers tell us. So we have to approach it on two fronts. One is to focus on security itself, and the other is we have to focus on streamlining the security processes to make them as passenger-friendly as possible. Much of the effort is really designed to provide assurance to passengers, we should try to do that in a way that makes the process as smooth as possible. We reiterate the call on governments to develop and implement risk-based, outcome-based aviation security regimes. And we also call on governments to recognize the value of mutual recognition of their respective security regimes in order to avoid unnecessary duplication of effort. Again, we find a lot of overlapping and duplication of effort, rescreening of things, rescreening of passengers, rescreening of bags, and so on. Mutual recognition of respective security regimes would avoid that, make the system more efficient without in any way diminishing security. Thirdly, on the environment, there have been some big achievements in ICAO, both on the CO2 standard and the agreement on a carbon offsetting scheme, CORSIA. And we urge governments to fully support and participate in ICAO's CORSIA scheme. It's a 15-year scheme starting from 2020. The first 6 years are voluntary in nature, but 68 governments have already signed up, and we applaud them for that. And they represent more than 80% of emissions internationally. We encourage other governments to also participate from the commencement of the scheme. And we will be supporting ICAO efforts to implement the scheme in a way that is effective and harmonized worldwide. I also reiterate the point about aviation infrastructure, because there is an environmental dimension to that, and we encourage governments to commit the necessary investment in infrastructure to keep pace with the growth in demand. On passenger facilitation, streamlining flows through security checkpoints and also border crossing. We have a lot of available technologies, biometric, machine-readable passports. There is an opportunity here to automate procedures. Airlines are using that, airports are doing that, but the border control process is still lagged behind, and they're not integrated. I think there are good opportunities to integrate these systems in a way that streamlines the flow for passengers. We already provide information about passengers through API data, PNR data, and that should benefit travelers and at the same time maintain or enhance the controls that governments wish to see on people crossing borders. So we call on governments to promote use of available technologies to do that, to make sure that the resources are available so as to streamline passenger facilitation and enhance the travel experience. We need a practical balance between effective security measures and efficient passenger facilitation. And implementing, again, implementation in line with global standards and recognizing mutual recognition of respective security regimes also helps the public. Moving on to taxes and charges. Airlines, the airline industry bears a variety of taxes and charges. But some governments impose onerous taxes on the industry. We believe these are counterproductive because they make travel more expensive, they inhibit travel, and travel itself has indirect benefits in terms of supporting tourism. So we believe overall it's counterproductive. There are cases where governments have reversed such taxes in realizing that it was a mistake, but there are still cases where some governments have onerous charges and taxes, and we argue against that. Often the public is unaware of the magnitude of these charges because they're collected together with the airfares, and there's some confusion as to, which of course suits governments, but conceals the fact that they are being taxed. Also on charges, where we're paying a charge for a service that's received, ICAO has well-established principles of transparent, fair, and non-discriminatory charges, and we urge airports and air navigation service providers to continue to comply with those principles. And lastly, we have a resolution on health pandemics. Historically, air travel has been affected by health-related crises, and the concern here is that national health authorities tend to react to the threat of pandemics in the early stages without careful thought about the implications. The United Nations World Health Organization is the body that is responsible for concerted action globally on this issue, and the airline industry and the World Health Organization do work closely together in terms of what is the right response Is it exit checks? Is it arrival checks? What forms of precautions? What form of information gathering? What exactly is the nature of the threat? What is the risk assessment? And so on and so forth. But as we found most recently from the Zika virus, some countries act first and think later. And the imposition of arbitrary checks on aircraft disinfection or travel restrictions, whilst well-intentioned, are ill-considered and counterproductive. Again, once they're put in place, it's hard to persuade people to reverse them, even if they've forgotten what the purpose was. So we're calling on governments to collaborate with WHO and other governments in managing the potential impact of health pandemics, to focus collective efforts on fighting the spread of diseases at source and by properly informing and educating the traveling public. And we also call on governments and health authorities to avoid imposing measures that would unnecessarily disrupt normal operations, particularly if it's a disproportionate impact compared to the actual risk level. And I would highlight that in the case of the Ebola outbreak, it was aviation that kept communities connected, enabled doctors and medical supplies to reach affected areas. And that's true in terms of general humanitarian response and assistance. Aviation is always at the forefront of those efforts and plays an important role in disaster recovery and humanitarian assistance. So we need to also bear that in mind in cases where, whether it's health pandemics or other natural disasters, how aviation is also a part of the solution rather than something to be targeted. In the mistaken belief that closing down travel will somehow help to prevent the spread of diseases. It doesn't. So understanding that. WHO understand this well, and we have a good working relationship as an industry with them. With that, it's quite a lot. Apologies for the detail of that, and there's more details in the press release, but now I'll throw it open to questions of a general nature. One item of caution is we're here to talk about AAPA business. You may be tempted to ask about Philippine Airlines or China Airlines or others. I'm afraid I'll deflect those. You'll get a chance to ambush my colleagues here later on or tonight or whatever. But for the moment, we're going to focus on AAPA business, but not confined to the resolutions. Any general questions of related to the industry or topics we've talked about today or anything else that's on your mind, please.
We now open the floor to your questions. There are available microphones. Please state your name and proceed to your question.
Peter Ricketts from Asia Pacific Aerospace Report. Could you give me an idea of just where you are in the Asian Open Skies scheme? I just don't know where it's at.
ASEAN?
Yes.
Yeah, ASEAN Open Skies, various milestones. I won't run through the actual protocols, but all of the member states have essentially endorsed those. There are very few restrictions left. Indonesia still has a list of only the five major ports. But in general, everything has now been liberalized. And so ASEAN carriers can fly pretty much anywhere within ASEAN. The other aspect of ASEAN is that ASEAN entered into a framework agreement with China. I described it as ASEAN plus X, where X was China. And that then led to liberal agreements, essentially open skies for Chinese carriers into ASEAN and ASEAN carriers into China. However, ASEAN carriers only have that right from their own states, not from any ASEAN states, so it's not entirely a reciprocal balanced agreement, but it is a big step forward. It also illustrated that ASEAN as a group can negotiate comprehensive agreements with another country. ASEAN has embarked upon initial talks with the EU towards a comprehensive agreement, as Henrik Holliday mentioned this morning. Those efforts, the culmination of several gatherings. I remember various gatherings in which we participated in the last couple of years, and has moved towards that. And is those discussions are not simply focused on air service agreements, but also wider regulatory issues, so which is not uncommon in modern air service agreements, looking at harmonization of other regulatory issues. But those are the initial stages. The European Union has got a mandate to negotiate with several other countries, but ASEAN is one of the block-to-block negotiations, so they have a mandate. So those talks have been started. I think he said the first round was Brussels in October, and the second round is, I think he said, Jakarta in January. But these things take time. And of course, within ASEAN, there is tremendous diversity of development stage, and the existing agreements between ASEAN countries and Europe and European countries vary in terms of the extent of the traffic rights that have been exchanged. So the starting point is complex, and the block-to-block agreement has to build on that. So we look forward to some progress. ASEAN's also in discussions with a number of other countries, I believe India, Japan, Korea. So there are a number of other areas. In general, across Asia, we're seeing progressive liberalization. It's very hard to point to any areas where the era of political liberalization hasn't kept up with the growth in demand. We're not seeing demand constrained, but some restrictions still exist which affect who serves the traffic, but I think you'll find it hard to find anywhere where capacity is constrained because of aeropolitical factors. That we have constraints in terms of lack of slots, lack of runway capacity, lack of airspace congestion, or whatever it may be. But those are infrastructure constraints, not aeropolitical constraints. One at the back somewhere.
Yeah, it's Tom Ballantyne from Orient Aviation. Continuing on with that issue of congestion and infrastructure shortfalls, Peter Bellew had some pretty pessimistic things to say during the panel about the ability of the system to cope with the growth that's going to be occurring over the next couple of decades. In terms of that, how successful are airlines being in talking to governments and getting them to fast-track infrastructure projects and realize what the issue is?
Well, if we talk infrastructure the way we normally discuss it, it's aviation-related: airports, runways, terminals, air navigation service capacity. Then those are big infrastructure, and they need, as I emphasized this morning, they need government planning approvals and their broad political processes, which take a lot of time. Peter Bellew was talking about some other issues, which is you fix aviation and you find there aren't sufficient attractions or there aren't sufficient hotel rooms or whatever. I don't disagree with his assessment, because you get these surges in travel which take people by surprise. So, for instance, mentioned Japan, or someone else mentioned Japan, you know, 20 million by 2020, they hit it in 15? And now they're aiming for 30 million. So you hear stories that, how's it going into Japan? Well, we've got long lines at immigration, we're short of buses, and we're finding it difficult to find hotel rooms. So who would have thought that in Japan? My own view is the technology to build hotels, buy buses, expand capacity for attractions, those things don't really depend on government approvals. The private sector can respond. So I see those as short-lived issues, and there's no shortage of willingness to build hotels and so on. But I think he's right to identify it, that it may cause spillover of effects. And it does lead to strange situations where airlines are buying hotels or securing hotel rooms or building hotel rooms. Which is a pointer. But I think the solution is in the private sector. The problem with the airport infrastructure is they're massive projects, and we know they get held up in the planning process. So I categorize them rather differently. But interesting comments and flagging opportunities, and not necessarily seeking governments to do it. Unless, of course, governments have said you can't build hotels or you can't get a permit or whatever it may be. But in most countries, those sorts of things. The other thing is some countries, if you insist on local investment, you may find a capital constraint. But again, most Asian countries have welcomed foreign investment in hotels, hospitality, and tourism, and it stood them in good stead. That's why you see the growth of travel and tourism rapidly developing markets. But it's right to not just look at our own sector. We have to think in terms of the overall position, and who would have done a project plan that said 10 million, 20 million, 30 million, or outbound 60 million, 100 million, 120 million, and still growing. So we do need to think in terms of rather expansive terms. But opportunity more than a constraint or a threat, short-term threat, but opportunity signaled. Any more? One at the front here, probably about cargo.
Hi, Greg Noller, IHS. It's not about cargo, but I think last year I asked you the same question about also about infrastructure, about Shanghai, the mainland, the delays, and that's something that does not seem to have any solution. And that is a lot of that is because of the government, because it's controlled by the military. What I mean, do you see this continuing forever, or will there ever be a resolution to the delays in and out of China?
Well, I'm old enough to remember when the Chinese market was about 2 million passengers a year, and now it's about 1.5 million passengers a day, probably in the 450, heading towards 500 million passenger market. The battle between military requirements and civil requirements is a common discussion all around the world, and it looms large in China because of the way it's structured. They're very conscious of this. You can track the on-time performance at airports in China, and it has deteriorated markedly, but recently it has shown significant improvement, because they have been doing a lot to free up more airspace and to get some more flexibility about airspace usage between civil and military. They've opened up additional routes, they've opened up parallel routes, they've added additional capacity. The system is still fragile, much as Heathrow is fragile. When you're running close to capacity, if you get disruption like thunderstorms or other weather disruption, it does cause a knock-on cascade effect, so you get massive disruptions. So there's still some fragility in the system, but things have improved, and it's evident in the on-time performance overall. So they're taking steps. It's a very large, complex system. It involves multiple stakeholders within China. They have the technology. They have an exemplary safety record, which they're keen to preserve and further enhance, which makes them rather conservative in terms of air traffic management. But there's no real fault in that. But they are discussing, you know, what steps can be taken. So things are improving. But having said that, demand keeps on growing. So it's a moving target. Just as you make improvements, the task gets bigger as well. And particularly around Beijing, Shanghai, Guangzhou, the airports are extremely congested in terms of slots and slot constraints. Again, they're victims of success, but essentially it's the air traffic management capacity, and they are working hard on it, and they're open to suggestions from foreign expertise, but the technology's got to be adapted to the circumstances within China, and it's not so much the technology, they've got modern technology, but it's the procedures, and those need to be carefully thought through. The other issue is flow control. They're introducing new flow control mechanisms, just as Eurocontrol tries to wrestle with the situation in Europe and the FAA in America. There are initiatives to improve that, introduce new flow control mechanisms within China. And the last thing I'd say is that the international traffic is growing, of course, and China has to work with people around the region to streamline the flows to and from China and also across the region. And they're actively involved in doing that. ICAO set up a regional sub-office, which happens to be based in Beijing, although it could have been based elsewhere, and those teams work on streamlining air traffic management around the region, not just in China, but elsewhere. So again, they're closely involved, not just in terms of China, but also working with counterparts in the rest of the region. The problem for Asia generally is that flow control can't be delegated to a central authority like Eurocontrol. In Asia, we have to work collaboratively across jurisdictions. You might have to go through 6 or 7 FIRs and jurisdictions to get from Southeast Asia to North Asia. You want seamless flow, so you need communications and decentralized decision making. But achieving the same objectives of smoothing the flows, so there's a lot of activity going on there. So overall, some challenges, but overall, the system is coping, and you know, there's a lot of effort going into addressing the problems you identified, and some progress is being made. Sorry, one last thing. The coordination of civil military is they're addressing, and it's a common problem elsewhere in Europe or in the States. The other thing is that ATMB and China have agreed, IATA are placing a person inside ATMB to improve communications with the airline community on operational developments and policy discussions. So that's a recent initiative by IATA and ATMB, which we support. Question there?
Yes, Andy. Christine McGee here from Orient Aviation. I wanted to ask you about aviation environment and CORSIA. What is your response as the Director General of the AAPA to critics who say that CORSIA is too little too late and not enough of the big number of members are involved in the voluntary stage, and lastly, that it's not going to really do anything to substantially reach the long-term target through emissions reductions?
Yes, I've seen comments to that effect, and it's interesting, especially for those who've been involved in working on this for so long. And it's a misperception, but it's interesting why it would arise. As I emphasized, we've been working on fuel efficiency, technology, operations, infrastructure improvements. We continue to do so. We can point to a track record of continuous improvement. But traffic growth is outpacing that, so our emissions footprint as an industry is growing by about 3% per annum. And that will double over 25 years at 3%. So there is a challenge, but the four-pillar strategy and particularly the complementary market-based measure will deliver on the CNG 2020 target. Now, the criticism of the GMBM is that it's voluntary in the first 6 years, but 68 states have already volunteered, and they represent about 80% of international emissions. So you're already well on the way towards achieving that target, and the shortfall is more in the matter of it's a couple of years late in meeting the target as opposed to the gap being very significant. The word voluntary sounds half-hearted, but once you've volunteered, it's not where, as I said this morning, governments volunteer and you've been volunteered. And even countries who don't volunteer, they will have to report emissions for all operators. So participation in the reporting is going to be universal. And the participation, even in the voluntary phase, is going to be all the major players. China committed very early on, pre-committed before the deal was even done, that they were there for going for a deal. The US, if you look at the ranking of international emissions, there's a table in ICAO. US, China, in fact, is slightly bigger than the US now in international aviation emissions, followed by UAE, followed by a number of major European countries. And so you can go through. Also, that 68 volunteers includes countries that would be under no obligation. They'd be exempt as developing countries or small island states. A number of them volunteered to show willing and because they recognize that the scheme is worth supporting and will achieve the objectives. I also emphasize that nothing about the GMBM diminishes our effort on the other pillars. It's only the combination of all pillars, four pillars or five pillars, depending on how you count them, including alternative fuels. It's all of the pillars together that would deliver on the goals, and we will deliver. If there is a shortfall because of some lack of enthusiasm on the part of some states, and there were reservations filed by India, that's the price of reaching a compromise. But I don't think it should undermine faith in the integrity of the scheme or the seriousness of it. As to why it's not starting until 2021, just getting the scheme implemented as opposed to a framework, turning it into a real scheme, it takes time. These are complicated. So it's taken a long time, but it's the first global industry to have such an agreement, and I think the governments should be applauded. Like all things, it's a compromise. Someone said, you know, you should never see laws or sausages being made because it would put you off for life. And this is a sausage made of many components, but it is a deal. We've been through many of these meetings where we didn't have a consensus. We had divisions. And the fact that there was consensus involving the major states, both developed and developing, is a testament to the effort. And I think Henrik paid tribute to the fact that Indus has been pushing for this, and without that push, we wouldn't have got to the point where we are. So I think it's a bit churlish to dismiss it as too little, too late, or no pain, no gain, or whatever. Nobody who's involved in the process feels that, and I speak for some of the NGOs as well in that regard, who could say, well, it could be more ambitious and it could have come sooner, but they're just as pleased as we are that a deal that is done and is going to take effect and will work is something to be applauded. The ambition could be ramped up later, but that's a matter for consensus amongst governments. But overall, it's good news, and that was the message at the UNFCCC COP22 in Marrakesh, where they spoke in favor of what ICAO has done, and a number of other people made the same remarks, including Ban Ki-moon, the Secretary General of United Nations, I believe.
All right, we will take two more questions. Please go ahead.
Hello, it's Jordan Chong from Australian Aviation.
Hi.
I'm just wondering, in terms of the taxes and charges, I'm just wondering what more industry bodies such as yourselves can do to highlight to governments about the levels of these charges, given what was in the resolution today. And we have seen these charges go up in a number of countries, such as Australia. What sort of more can you do? And I guess maybe what can an airline do to sort of impress upon governments about the negative impacts of these charges?
It's a good question. And the danger is when an airline complains about a tax like this, it sounds like the airline is not wanting to pay. And there's not much sympathy for that, because airlines have lots of cash, everyone knows. It's not us going to pay it, it's the consumers. And one has to shine a light on it. And in Australia, the current campaign, shining a light on it is to highlight, what is the magnitude of these taxes? How much are people paying? If you want to emphasize it, how much are you paying if you go on holiday with your partner, or if you go on holiday as a family of four? What is it costing you for these things? And how do people feel about it? And governments respond to public feedback. As I mentioned this morning, part of the problem is these charges are buried inside ticket prices and people aren't aware. Just highlighting the fact that it's there, what's it costing, how do people feel about that? That's how the political pressure comes to bear. As far as the direct impact, there have been some experiments where someone introduces the charge in the Netherlands and people said, well, I can drive across the border and go to an airport nearby, which doesn't have the same charges, and we saw that. We've seen in Ireland who backed off some charges and found that business improved. We've seen some other cases. So, and you can commission econometric studies from consultancies and so on. So overall, you've got to recognize it's not what it's doing to the airline industry, it's what it's doing to passenger behavior and overall. And if you do deter travel, inhibit travel, the charts that Michael Gill of ATAC showed this morning, it's not just the aviation industry, it's all the travel and tourism and all the indirect jobs in the and food and beverage and hospitality and attractions that you jeopardize. So, people are price sensitive, and there's also a signaling effect that countries that make you jump through hoops and pay large visa fees put you off traveling. And it's the same for if there's a hefty tax, you kind of think, well, they don't sound like they're welcoming us. So there's a signaling effect as well. Why would you signal? You say you're promoting tourism. One of the ironies is the Americans who have a $14 charge for the ESTA to promote tourism into America. $10 of it goes to promoting tourism. Not charging it would be a way of promoting tourism, but that's a separate discussion.
And for the final question, go ahead.
Hi, Karen Walker, Transport World. It struck me through the proceedings at this event that at pretty much every briefing and every discussion, China comes up one way or another, the numbers, the growth, all sorts of ways. Any thoughts, any discussion going on about the need or desire, ability to get more Chinese mainland carriers, or to get the Chinese mainland carriers as part of AAPA?
Yeah, the door's open, and we've been enjoying good dialogue and relations with the Chinese Airlines, but also with the CAC, the regulator. Of course, not always on the same page, because like all regulators, we have views about what they should do, whether their new rules on passenger rights and so on, where there has been a consultation process, and they have taken into account the views we and others, including IATA, have expressed. And on air traffic management, as we were just discussing, we have some tough conversations as well. But in terms of the general principle of them wanting to engage and encouraging Chinese airlines to engage in international associations such as AAPA or IATA and so on, they've signaled they think that would be a good thing. There is also a Chinese Air Transport Association, which is a domestic trade association, which isn't entirely an airline trade association. It's more of an offshoot of CAC, which manages such issues as licensing of non-airline aviation-related activities, deciding on dangerous goods regulations or whatever it may be. But we have a very good working relationship with them too. One thing we have to watch out for is we've been very active on the environmental agenda, as we've been talking about, and that's a tricky one because we've been at the forefront of, from an Asian perspective, of course, saying you have to take into account the developing countries, not just in Asia, but generally, and we need a global solution that recognizes the need to balance the interests of developed and developing. And in Asia, we, of course, have both. We have rich, developed, and developing, and large and small, but rich and poor. But you saw in the case of climate policy, where the Chinese airlines weren't able to voice their own views because their government had given them clear instructions that this was a government policy matter. So you had the strange situation in IATA at the AGM on more than one occasion where the Chinese airlines made statements on behalf of their governments and some others. So this question of, you know, what can airlines voice views on and when do governments say, none of your business, you know, this is a government matter. So you have to be mindful of that when it comes to but there's a lot of common ground. When we talk to the Chinese airlines, they have the same concerns. Infrastructure, slots, charges, government policy, passenger rights. And there are times when I think they would feel that an international voice voicing in opinions, they'd feel a lot of common ground. But step by step. In terms of the market potential, undoubted. And of course, it's real, inbound, outbound. Lots and lots of activity, as you heard from various people. But not the only story. India has a lot of potential, unfulfilled, so largely unfulfilled, but ahead of us, if the right moves are made. And in the bigger scheme of things, don't underestimate the scale of the Philippines market, the Vietnamese market, the Indonesian market. I didn't mention Indonesia specifically, but they're due to, I think, get to about number six in the next 15 years. You know, the Asian growth story is not just about China, but China's a big, big part of it. And this year, the Chinese airlines have become very internationally focused. In the past, it was mostly domestic, but they've been going very big on the Pacific, and their products now are competitive internationally in terms of premium products as well. So a lot of exciting things happening. So good to mention it. Thanks.